Thank you. I was speaking yesterday, if you remember, about the various surrogates for God which one can find in the modern era, and claimed that of all of these, culture, in the broad anthropological sort of way of life sense of culture, was the greatest. I mean by the greatest, the most convincing, and for a while, the most effective. After all, culture in that broad sense, like religion, involves ritual practices, some sensuous symbolism, moral values, spiritual growth, a communal identity, inner experience, and a transformative social mission. So it's not hard to see it as a secularized version of religious faith, unless one's a Kierkegaard for whom the passionate interiority of faith is at odds with all such collective forms. I also suggested, if you remember yesterday, that part of the power of religion sprang from its success in combining the two chief senses of culture, namely, you know, roughly high and popular, or aesthetic and anthropological, within a single institution, linking theology to popular devotion, connecting the most fundamental and mysterious of truths to the daily practice of billions of men and women. Very hard to hold a candle for any other symbolic form to hold a candle to that astonishingly historically successful synthesis. The problem with culture itself, however, as modernity unfolded, was that it was unable to do the same. That's to say, it was really unable to bring those two chief meanings of culture, aesthetic and anthropological, the deepest values by which society lives and a whole practical way of life. It had great difficulty in bringing those together. As for culture, as far as culture in the narrower sense of the term is concerned, aesthetic culture, if you like, it's remarkable, as I think I said yesterday, how long it took the improbable, the grossly improbable doctrine that art might prove our salvation to die. It's to be found everywhere in Nietzsche. It manages to survive the collapse of the high Victorian consensus and the carnage of the First World War. It's to be found both Bloomsbury and Scrutiny peddle a version of it. Poetry, writes I.A. Richards with stunning offhandedness, is capable of saving us. After one's abandoned a belief in God, proclaims Wallace Stevens, poetry is that essence which takes its place as life's redemption. It's a note one can hear sounded as early as Mallarmé, who speaks of art as succeeding religion. So having done service for theology in its day, the aesthetic will now aim to supplant it entirely. The imagination as a form of grace is a constant motif in modernism. One thinks also of the redemptive power of memory in Proust, or the priestly vocation of the Joycean artist. Henry James finds in art a form of saintly self-immolation, while epiphanies of transcendence haunt the poetry of Rilke and the prose of Wolfe. An anthropology based on death, sacrifice, and rebirth informs the most celebrated of all English modernist poems, The Wasteland. High culture, however, was simply too minority a pursuit to step into religion's shoes, to prove redemptive in anything like the pervasive and transformative and thoroughgoing sense that would have been required. The whole notion is remarkable for its pathos. It's a kind of fantasy, an intellectual's fantasy. At the same time, however, culture in the broader sense of the term meets all kinds of problems, not least that it grows pathological with the advent of Nazism. Theodore Adorno speaks in chilling phrase of what he calls the horror teeming under the stone of culture. The three great demystifiers of modernity, Marx, Nietzsche, and Freud, all acknowledge in their various ways the blood and brutality that lie at the root of all good things, and that is bound to subvert a certain more innocent, more radiant notion of culture that doesn't grasp culture, let's say, as the sublimation of violence or the flip side of barbarism. The word that has come to signify the most complex form of civility is now bound up with the most unspeakable forms of debasement. A lesser form of debasement, you might argue, is born with the culture industry around the turn of the 20th century, as art is finally incorporated into general commodity production, a process that will reach its epitome with postmodernism. Now, the concept of culture in the broader sense has many sources: nationalism, the migration of peoples, imperialist anthropology, anti-capitalist romantic critique, the decline of religious faith, the rise of the culture industry, and so on. But I think one could do worse than name the French Revolution as one of its most vital progenitors, if only by negation. Culture, as Edmund Burke knew, with its geologically slow time, its gradually sedimented habits and taken for granted pieties, is a potent antidote to political revolution. It is an anti-political form of politics, really, as indeed is nationalism in a different way. The idea of cultural revolution, which would become on the agenda in the mid-20th century, is thus, for this way of thinking, something of an oxymoron, rather like, say, the phrase business ethics. Thank you very much. In the 20th century, however, culture in the broad sense, you know, not Bach or Beethoven, but the broad sense of kinship, lineage, identity, home, ethnicity, would become the very language of political conflict. Not, as Matthew Arnold and others had hoped, the solvent of that conflict, as it were, the spiritual solution to real practical political problems. Culture had now shifted over from being part of the solution to being part of the problem. And in our own time, that's been repeated as culture and political militancy have formed a new kind of alliance in the shape of radical Islam. With postmodernism, cultural politics is less an oxymoron than a tautology. Politics becomes cultural. But once culture shifts over to being part of the problem, there can be no salvation in it. The salvation can only be a form of politics of some kind. These two versions of culture then will be riven apart in the epoch of modernity to be reunited in a fashion by postmodernism. Aesthetic culture with postmodernism becomes populist, demotic, and streetwise, while culture in as a way of life becomes increasingly aestheticized. There's a sort of crossover between the two. But neither concept of culture now momentously can operate as critique, even in the most idealist of fashions. Both of these senses of culture, one of the places, the major places where they're last in some kind of consort, but a consort of a rather conflictive kind, it can be found in Matthew Arnold's Culture and Anarchy, a text which betrays a whole series of surreptitious slides from the one meaning of culture to the other. The crisis is already brewing up. Culture has not been, as it were, discredited and demystified as a solvent of political conflict, but it's in bad trouble, and Arnold's text comes right out of that kind of crisis, because culture for Arnold is now both, in that text, problem and solution, temporal and eternal, a practical social mission, yet also sweetness and light, the process of attaining perfection and perfection itself. It signifies aesthetic cultivation, but also a corporate social identity, and as the latter, it offers a familiar solution to class struggle. In Literature and Dogma, the political basis of Arnold's case is revealed with a certain disarming candour. The chief political problem, he declares there, is, I quote, the lapsed masses. Many of the common people, he argues in his companion work, God and the Bible, have embraced, I'm quoting, a kind of revolutionary deism hostile to all which is old, traditional, established and secure, with the classes now in the background for chief actors. What is bringing religion into disrepute, in short, is the labour movement, which increasingly rejects the Bible as an outdated superstition, with exquisite diplomacy, Arnold omits to point out that he holds just the same view of the Bible himself. What's at work here, in fact, is yet another version of what I called yesterday the double truth doctrine. There's no harm in civilized gentlefolk like Arnold doubting the divinity of Christ, but it's a different question when it comes to trade union militants. One is not always to attack people's illusions about religion, Arnold warns, because illusions they are. There's no harm in the odd illusion if it keeps the workers from laying their hands on private property. What disquieted intellectuals in the 18th century, as I was talking about yesterday, was the superstition of the populace. Now it's the scepticism of the populace which is the problem. The situation has reversed itself. The progressively minded deists are now militant working men, not middle-class philosophers. If the rationality of the Enlightenment was too icily remote from the piety of the populace, religion is now too distant from the increasingly agnostic masses. The whole problematic has shifted from the middle of one century, if you like, to the middle of the next. The solution to this problem for Arnold is not to reconstruct the populace, but to revise the Bible. Culture, he declares, is essential if the Bible is to reach the people. What does he mean by that? Well, really, he means that culture, in the sense of a free, flexible, non-dogmatic sort of Oxford High Table spirit, must empty the Bible of its rebarbative religious doctrine, retaining, however, its numinous aura, its emotive rhetoric, its moral uplift, its high moral tone, and sell it to the masses as a species of edifying poetry, which will be soothing and consoling. I assure you I don't caricature. Arnold's perfectly capable of doing that for himself. The people, Arnold remarks rather discreetly, have not much aptitude for dogma, involving, as it does, a degree of reasoning. The task of the literati, then, people like him, is to insist on the figurative or poetic nature of what might otherwise be taken as gospel truth, rejected on rationalist grounds, and therefore might shake the foundations of political society. One can't do with Christianity, but one can't do without it either. So to poeticize scripture away, retrieving the poetic kernel from the dogmatic shell, provides the humble literary critic with a startling new social importance. He's shot right, as it were, to the centre of political debate. The religious feelings, Arnold declares, are those of love, reverence, gratitude, hope, pity, and awe, which, as you might have noticed, are not exactly politically innocent. Religion is a question of tone, moral uplift, and poetic quality. It's a far cry from the Yahweh who tells the Jews that their incense stinks in his nostrils. Liberalism, Arnold writes, as a liberal himself, of course, is an insufficient creed at these times of crisis. We're speaking about the Second Reform Bill, about Labour militancy, and so on, and must yield to some more absolutist faith. This is a liberal speaking. Doctrines of social equality must be replaced, therefore, with more resonant phrases, such as the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom, even though Arnold himself doesn't believe in the Lord and has not the slightest fear of him. One might say here that, among other things, religion survives as self-sacrifice, meaning the citizen's self-immolation for the corporate good. George Eliot preaches, of course, much the same doctrine, as do the positivists with whom she was allied. From the Quantists to the Neo-Hegelians, a certain self-interested altruism is much in vogue. As Mrs. Humphrey Ward puts it in her novel Robert Ellesmere, society has need of a new social bond and will find it in an idea of culture that makes for selflessness. In this way, I quote, the rich devote themselves to the poor and the poor put up with the rich. Nice one, Humphrey. When one hears the word selflessness, one reaches for one's historical materialism. For the Feuerbachians and the religion of humanity, the point, once again, is not so much to reject religious faith as to rework it, to rewrite it. Why waste time on worshipping a supreme being when we could be engaged on the rather more gratifying task of worshipping ourselves? Emil Durkheim is another who sees religion primarily in corporate social terms as the cement of a divided industrial society, somewhat perhaps in the manner of Jacques Lacan's L'Autre, can step into the breach from which the deity has vanished and figure as a form of secularized otherness or transcendence. None of these thinkers seems aware that consensus doesn't rank very high in the priorities of the New Testament. It's far too busy promoting conflict and antagonism. It's with Nietzsche that the decisive break, I think, comes. There's a sense in which he's the first real atheist of the modern age, though he himself awarded that title to Schopenhauer, whose voracious will, another grisly parody of divinity, is yet another God surrogate. What Nietzsche sees is that as long as God's shoes are being filled by reason, art, culture, the imagination, the nation, humanity, the state, the people, society, moral orthodoxy, or some other specious form of divinity, the Almighty, although indubitably on the danger list, is not quite dead. He's delegated his affairs to various viceroys, part of whose task is to convince men and women that there's no cause for alarm, that business will be conducted as usual in the absence of the proprietor, and that the acting director, whoever he happens to be, is perfectly capable of handling all inquiries. Nietzsche thinks that you can only get rid of God if you get rid of inherent meaning. As long as there appears to be some intrinsic meaning in things, one can always inquire after its ultimate donor. Max Weber writes that every theology presupposes that the world has meaning and only a plucky few can acknowledge that it does not. The Übermensch for Weber is, in short, the social scientist, able to confront nihilism without spurious consolation. For those who can't attain this dangerous truth, Weber comments, the doors of the old churches are open widely and compassionately. It's our old friend again, the double truth thesis. The masses live in salutary illusion, while the more enlightened of the intelligentsia stare unflinchingly into the void. Nietzsche is out to convict the middle classes of intolerable bad faith when it comes to theology. You can't kick away the foundations of the building and still expect it to stand. The death of God, he remarks in The Joyful Wisdom, is the most momentous event of human history. Yet men and women, this is me now rather than Nietzsche, men and women are behaving as though it were no more than a minor injury. Their crime is less deicide than cowardice and rank hypocrisy. Having murdered the creator in the most audacious of all Oedipal revolts, they've hidden the body, suppressed all memory of the traumatic event, tidied up the crime scene, and like Norman Bates in Psycho, behave as though nothing has happened. They've dissembled their audacious deicide with various shamefaced forms of pseudo-religion, which is to say, among other things, that secular capitalist society has disposed of God by virtue of its own inherently secular, pragmatic, profane, rationalist activities, but finds it politically and ideologically convenient to behave as though it does not. There is, in Marxist terms, a certain discrepancy there between base and superstructure. And one of the respirators on which the Almighty has been kept artificially alive is known as morality. In Nietzsche's view, however, it's idle to imagine that our conceptions of truth, virtue, identity, autonomy, our sense of history as shapely and coherent, all of which have deep-seated theological sources, idle to imagine that this could possibly survive the cataclysm intact. The death of God must spell the death of man. A point, incidentally, with which Christian faith, in a quite different sense, is in entire agreement. Only one who can embrace the truth can peer into the frightful abyss of the real and find in the death of God the birth of a new species of humanity. As with Christian faith itself, then, for the Übermensch, the only place to begin is with a confession that our hands are steeped in the blood of divinity. Only then can the Übermensch truly oust the creator by imperiously creating his own values. Postmodernism, which I suppose is really one long footnote to Nietzsche, inherits something of this vision, but lacks Nietzsche's tragic sense. It inherits this vision, as it were, without the tragedy. It's post-tragic, though post in the sense that Morrissey comes after Mozart, not in the sense that Badiou comes after Marx. I mean, to be really post, of course, you have to go all the way through it, whatever your post, and come out somewhere on the other side, not just to be, as it were, after it, in the sense that Madonna is after Darwin. For postmodernism, the absence of given meaning is just the way the world is. What else would you expect? No scandal or tragedy or trauma there to be confronted and surmounted. It's true that there's no redemption, but there's nothing to be redeemed. Whereas modernism experiences the death of God as trauma, scandal, a cause for anguish and disquiet, as well as celebration, postmodernism doesn't experience it at all. It's too young to do so. There's no God-shaped hole in its universe, as there is, say, for Kafka or Beckett. Truth, reality, identity, foundations, and so on have evaporated, but they've left no spectres behind them. Their absence is no more palpable than the absence of a baseball bat in the hands of the Mona Lisa. There is no absence. Everything is present and correct as it is. It's only some metaphysical hankering which punches a hole in this universe. Meanwhile, again, post-Nietzsche, the human subject is now far too dwindled and depleted to be up to anything as strenuous as forging its own identity or values in a Nietzschean style. There are simply too many video games to be consumed. In this sense, man is no longer in danger of being mistaken for the Almighty, not because God doesn't play video games, unless that's the reason why he's taken his eye off the world and allowed people like Mel Gibson to slip into existence, but because he's no longer grasped as a creative agent. Let's say man is no longer grasped as a creative agent. At the same time, postmodernism is suspicious not just of religious faith, but of faith as such, a relatively new development, certainly, and one appropriate, as it were, to a late capitalism where it certainly, whatever it is that coheres the system, it sure isn't belief of any kind, yes? I mean, as long as people roll into work and don't break shop windows and don't assault police officers and pay their taxes, they can believe what they want. Belief, too much belief, too definitive belief is both politically divisive, potentially, and commercially superfluous, yes? Which is, of course, the reason why, as forgive me if you heard me say this before, the reason why a whole generation today of young people says like every 4 seconds, yes? That's the reason. Let's make no mistake about it. To say something like, it's 9 o'clock, is unpleasantly authoritarian and doctrinaire, whereas it's like 9 o'clock is suitably provisional, tentative, hesitant, and so on. In this sense, one might claim, not just in the sense I've just been talking about, but in general, postmodernism is genuinely post-religious. Man has a finally attained maturity, so-called, a concept one won't, of course, find in Freud, but only at the cost of abandoning his self-determination. As long as he's still seen primarily as man, is still primarily seen as producer, as agent, as labourer, as self-fashioner, God is not quite dead. Even God, however, can't survive man as eternal consumer. Postmodernism, to be sure, finds its own rather fetishized brand of otherness, of transcendence in a rather fetishized brand of otherness, but there's no longer any other to this otherness, no longer any sustaining ground of the other or big other, just as there's no longer any other to culture itself. Culture is now what goes all the way down, as God used to do. It too is a shamefaced form of foundationalism. Indeed, you might say the latest shamefaced form of foundationalism. as the power, the traditional power of religion begins to fade, its various functions are redistributed like a precious legacy among those aspiring to become its heirs. Scientific rationalism takes over its doctrinal certainties, while radical politics inherits its mission to transform the world. Culture, in the aesthetic sense, preserves something of the spiritual depth of religion, while culture, in the broader sense, seeks to restore something of its communitarian ethos. We've seen already the difficulties with which those two versions of culture are beset as modernity unfolds. What happens when we arrive then at the postmodern era, if you like, is that the various substitutes with which modernity sought to replace religion are themselves replaced or dismantled. If Durkheim proclaims society as a kind of surrogate deity, Jean Baudrillard will announce the end of the social itself. If Arnold offers culture as a demystified version of God, postmodernism offers a demystified version of culture. High modernism replaces the halo of divinity with the aura of art, which postmodernism dismantles in its turn. If idealism and romanticism replace God with the fathomless, infinite, all-powerful subject, postmodernism leaves us with what Perry Anderson has called a subjectivism without a subject. If God is dead, then man too, for Michel Foucault, is rapidly approaching his end. There isn't much left to deconstruct. And then, just at that moment, in enormous historical irony, what breaks violently into this post-metaphysical, post-religious, post-historical, post-modern world is religion, as the World Trade Center bites the dust. The world is now divided increasingly between those who believe too little, Western chief executives and so on, and those, whether Texan or Taliban, who believe too much. And then there are those like myself who stand in the middle, you know, equitably balancing both views, believing neither too much nor too little. Don't worry. No sooner has the deity been banished from the scene than he's back on the political agenda with a vengeance, but now as a wrathful, satanic, dark-haired, dark-skinned deity, one on the side of barbarism and not, as in the great imperialist adventure, on the side of civilization, one who is no longer nailed down securely in his coffin, but has simply changed address to the US Bible Belt and the slums of the Arab world, to all those places which feel betrayed and abandoned by advanced capitalist modernity and are determined to make its presence felt by exploding bombs in marketplaces. In other words, having murdered God, modernity itself has now, quite against its own intentions, succeeded in bringing him back again, putting him back into business as a refuge and a strength for all those who feel trampled over and humiliated by its own Western modernity's own predatory politics. In this situation, culture is no longer a substitute for religion. The two are far too closely interwoven to be easily distinguishable. Nor can culture and politics be seen as opposites in the manner of Burke or the manner of high modernism or the manner of Kulturkritik. On the contrary, politics has now allowed culture in the sense of specific forms of life to gain a new and formidable momentum. In their different ways, very different ways, both postmodernism and radical Islam run culture and politics together after their high modernist separation. Then, in a further twist, as the so-called war on terror took hold, it was as though the narrative I've been recounting in these lectures came full circle, was thrown violently into reverse as a new off-the-peg, reach-me-down version of enlightenment was promulgated by the so-called new atheism. No sooner had postmodernism dismissed truth, science, progress, reason, objectivity as so many chimeras, than these very values were mobilized once more by a slightly panic-stricken sector of the Western liberal intelligentsia in the face of an assault from the East. There were several reasons for this, but one of them was surely that given the religious menace looming from the East, the West had need of a self-apologia rather more compelling, rather more resourceful than anything that a pragmatist relativist postmodernism had to offer. For some thinkers then, grand narratives of science, reason, progress have returned, various vulgarized forms of enlightenment, only a few years after postmodernism declared them obsolete, rather as the collapse of the World Trade Center opened up history again just after it was being declared definitively over by certain post-historical ideologues in the West. Yet while some of the liberal intelligentsia proclaimed their atheism in the face of Islamic fundamentalism, others, like Alain de Botton and John Gray, turned to religion to counteract the spiritual vacancy of advanced capitalism, or rather turn to some suitably Arnoldian poeticized version of religion. The Quantist program, astonishingly ludicrous even in its own time, is being refurbished by those who have no faith whatsoever in any god in particular, but who nevertheless fear the political consequences of pervasive faithlessness. Simon Critchley's Faith of the Faithless, just published, is a kind of leftist counterpart to de Botton's impeccably liberal Religion for Atheists. Religious faith has rarely been so wildly popular among devout non-believers. As with some Enlightenment thinkers, one doesn't, of course, believe oneself, but it makes for civility, aesthetic charm, social order, and spiritual edification if you could bring yourself to believe. We're speaking, in other words, of a new current of what one might call reluctant atheists or latter-day Arnoldians from the later Derrida onwards, very much part of this camp, who speak of the claims of infinity while having not the slightest belief in any theological concept of infinity, and who, like George Steiner and Roger Scruton at various points in their careers, have absolutely everything of faith but the content of it. Liberal capitalist orders, not least when they enter as now into severe crisis, regularly look to some form or other, doesn't really matter what it is in some cases, of communitarianism to preserve their cohesion in the face of this kind of crisis, and religion will do as well as anything in this respect. It's really a cynical and deeply disingenuous lineage all the way from the Enlightenment double truth thesis onwards. Christianity, however, is not about social order, consensus, moral uplift, aesthetic charm, spiritual supplements, or ideological resources. It's about a crucified body. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. We now have some time for questions. Please do wait till a microphone comes. Indicate if you'd like to ask a question. The microphone will come to you. And use it, please, so that not only we can hear you, but that those who watch from elsewhere can hear you. Francis?
Ready for me to speak? Yes. Mm. Well, thank you for that. You've discussed religion in the 18th and 19th centuries. I don't think you've actually mentioned the evangelical revival at any point, which would be one of the major, obviously, global drivers within religion, and also possibly one of the major critiques of the view that I don't believe, but it's good that you should. Mm. I mean, would you like to comment on the idea that the evangelical revival, to some extent, transcended the divisions between classes? And I wonder also if you've got any views on the position the positions offered by David Bebbington over the last 20 years, who has argued that the evangelicalism is part of the Enlightenment project, or if you would still be with the E.P. Thompson camp on Methodism, who famously described it as the chiliasm of despair.
You have no idea how many things I didn't mention in that lecture. I haven't really thought about that, to be honest. It's an interesting question, and I should think more about it. It's almost a cliche, isn't it, to say it's a very contradictory phenomenon in that respect, not to be unequivocally, you know, put on the side of the status quo and social order, nor unequivocally on the side of dissent. Form strange and contradictory alliances with various forms of political dissent and so on. Insofar as it has an enormous animus against a certain kind of rather inert establishment theological politics, then it certainly fits into part of what I'm saying. Insofar as it may resort to the false solution of faith as privacy and individualism, as I mentioned about Kierkegaard, then it can sit loose in a way to many of these questions. Yes, I mean, people like Kierkegaard, a certain kind of radical Protestantism is just not very interested in culture. Yes, that's all I really could say about that. Just to elaborate the last point, perhaps very slightly. One of the great gains of Arnold's work, and indeed it goes all the way back certainly to Coleridge and Burke and De Maistre and so on, is the point where culture can no longer afford to be simply a private or individual matter. I think that's a momentous historical and, as it were, etymological shift in the idea of culture, that what was once very much identified with a form of individual cultivation or privilege or interiority or civility, yes, can now, under certain new political pressures, no longer simply be that. Arnold sees that. You know, he's nostalgic, as it were, for that sense of culture, but it will no longer suffice. You have to have, culture has to become in some way corporate. Yes. So I would, you know, I would want to look, I suppose, as far as the terms of this argument goes, at evangelicalism partly in those terms. How far does the false solution of faith as essentially private and non-political enter into it, and how far is that in tension with very definitely political forms of non-conformist dissidence?
Perhaps I should say I'm a spiritual Western chief executive, just to put my positioning straight. I'd like to go back to your introduction yesterday, because I thought it was a very interesting breakdown between the intelligentsia having rationalizations and whatever, and the masses being simplistic. But when you get to our leaders, then the intelligentsia sort of has to simplify it again. I mean, if you're talking to a George W. Bush or Margaret Thatcher, it sort of goes from being, shall we say, quite complex to becoming suddenly quite simplistic again. I wonder if you would just like to comment.
I wouldn't actually myself include either Bush or Thatcher in the category of intelligentsia. I mean, what's at stake here, surely, particularly in what I was saying about the Enlightenment, is not only the complex relations between the intelligentsia and the people. And of course, the view of the people as simple, faithful is the intelligentsia's view of them, which I'm not necessarily endorsing. But also, of course, the view of the complex relations between the politicians and the philosophers, yeah, between the intelligentsia as the eminence grise, as the powers behind the throne, you know, the Leo Strauss, as I said yesterday, to George W. Bush, and the pragmatic business of power itself. So there's a lot of complexity, complex relations there. Intellectuals tend to complexify things, and if they're in positions of political influence or authority, they've got to find some way of selling those in a more, not necessarily a more simple way, but in a kind of, as I was saying yesterday, in terms of image and narrative and symbol and so on. There needs to be a certain translation, and that was part of what I was saying yesterday, if you remember, about the role of mythology, which is at one time thought to be able to do this. Once it's, I'll just finish by saying, once it's clear that the two concepts of culture can't be stitched together, yeah? If you like the culture of the intelligentsia and the culture of the people, then you're in real trouble. Because, as it were, culture is, I think, the last attempt, the last ditch attempt, in a way, to make that kind of synthesis.
Thank you for your talk. At the end, you said what Christianity was not, yeah, and what it was, a belief in the crucified body. But how does that work out in practice in the 21st century? I mean, I could easily think, well, does that mean I go into the monastery and ignore culture, society, etc.? So how does it work out in practice?
Well, whatever authentic form of culture, it doesn't, I think, mean abandoning the idea of culture or politics or society. It doesn't mean a monastic withdrawal from that. It means that whatever authentic forms of culture and politics and society there are would have to be based upon a recognition somehow of the meaning of a crucified body, of the meaning of crucifixion, right? And the belief that that crucifixion is in some sense the indispensable condition, the sine qua non of resurrection. No new life without crucifixion. Now, that is politically explosive, in my view, because that's not accepted at all by our orthodox and prevalent forms of politics. Yes, no new life without crucifixion. The rupture, the trauma, the discontinuity involved in that are simply, you know, too much to be taken by our contemporary forms of politics, our conventional forms of politics. So one would have to look to forms of political and cultural thought that understood what that meant, yeah? And they're few and far between. Marxism, I think, is one, as I've argued before, and as I argue in an extraordinarily cheap and remarkably attractive book that I've just published on Karl Marx. Sorry, that was meant to be funny. But yeah. But it's not the only one. In other words, our society, put it in slightly more psychoanalytic terms, our society is actually based in its thought forms, its political forms, its cultural forms, on a repression and disavowal of that real. Yeah? Now, which is bound to be disruptive if one, you know, tries to take it into account. And I don't think you can then pre-draft or predict the political and cultural forms that would flow from that, yes? But one can point to actual historical examples in our own time and before then of forms of politics that believe that it's only by such a compact with failure and loss and dispossession that any authentic political society has a chance in hell of surviving.
To what extent do you see Christianity as being a placeholder for other religions? Or does it have a special significance for your presentation of a worldview?
Well, it has a special significance in terms of what I've just said about it. I mean, what I just take to be the central tragic drama of crucifixion and resurrection, yeah? And the fact that any, as I just said, any authentic ethics or political thought has to come to terms with that, you know, can't just survive on its repression. But I'm not, on the other hand, claiming any monopoly over that, yes? I mentioned tragedy there because there's a whole rich and complex lineage of tragic insight, which includes that kind of insight, which is by no means simply Christian. Yeah, goes back before it. I think that as long as one believes that the only good God is a dead one, that's fine. Yeah. Yeah. And I mean, that belief can be expressed in various ways, but as long as you have some kind of satanic, fetishistic belief in some kind of big daddy, then, you know, we're not talking about faith, we're talking about some kind of consoling pagan. I mean, the kind of belief that, say, Richard Dawkins, the kind of Christianity Richard Dawkins has, by negation, you know, what Richard Dawkins thinks Christianity is about, you know, that absurd kind of idolatry and, satanic view of the deity and all that, which I take it Christianity is out to demystify. But, you know, that can be expressed in many different languages, not all of them religious. Yeah.
Okay, I asked a question yesterday. I hope I can ask one today as well. You just mentioned Richard Dawkins. I'm not perfectly familiar with your view of his theory or whatever.
Of whose theory?
Richard Dawkins.
Hi.
But I was wondering, you know, your lecture was really erudite yesterday and today, and maybe it's too much to ask for more, but somehow I get the impression that by exploring history of ideas, we get the impression that ideas have their own internal history, and that there is almost nothing that they depend upon. So perhaps I don't want to opt for Richard Dawkins, but there is a question of science. If any surrogate religion should account for crucified body, should, you know, the belief in crucified body in the 21st century, should it necessarily account for, you know, Big Bang theory or quantum physics and these sort of things? I hope I'm not simply repeating a position reiterated by Richard Dawkins. I'm simply asking, you know, about this evident, you know, scientific facts that were discovered in past 5 centuries or so.
Well, first of all, I agree with you that ideas don't come from nowhere, and ideas don't have an autonomous history, though neither do I think they're simply the reflexes of something else, yes? And indeed, in what I said today and yesterday, if you remember, I tried to look at ideas in certain historical and social contexts, advanced capitalism, rise of the middle class, and so on. But nevertheless, I mean, it's not a heresy or a crime also to look at the relative continuities and coherences in ideas over a period. As far as I understand the second point you made, which I don't understand fully, I'm afraid, but as far as all that Big Bang stuff goes, I mean, that of course is what Dawkins doesn't see, is that's got nothing to do with theology whatsoever. Yeah, I mean, theology isn't in the least interested in how the world got going. Dawkins doesn't understand that. Dawkins thinks that the doctrine of creation is about how the world came into being. You know, was it a Big Bang? Was it there forever? The doctrine of creation has nothing to do with that. That's why it's so hard to get any kind of dialogue going between that sort of vulgarized position and people who are talking about crucified bodies. Because whatever Dawkins is talking about, it sure isn't that.
Hello, I'm just to declare my position. I'm a third order Franciscan, yeah, which means that we follow St. Francis. He emulated Christ. I live with the notion of the crucifixion and the resurrection as part of my daily life, and I used it to help me get over redundancy. Was a good example of a change, which you see as an end and a new beginning. And I think the stages towards that point of crucifixion are also important. The changes you go on in the prior journey of losing your clothes, for instance, the humiliation, the being stripped of status and so on, does allow you to get to a point of humility from which you can then grow. And I think these are really important points at the level of the individual. A Franciscan writer, Richard Rohr, talks about falling upwards, and he talks about the wound within all of us. I just want to say that as the preamble to my question, which is crucifixion preceding resurrection at the level of the individual is certainly something we use. You're extrapolating, though, to the point of a society being crucified to be resurrected. I wonder if you could just say a little bit more about that. And extending the metaphor, the crucifixion and resurrection of Christ was prophesied. I wonder if you could say whether you think we've got any predictors about how these things may happen. Just as a final point, though, I must say part of the charisma of being a Franciscan is to totally respect the dignity and the inspiration of other faiths too. So I'm very mindful that we're using a Christian image here and all faiths have their own similar imagery. Sorry if that was a bit long-winded.
Yeah. I hope that respecting other faiths doesn't mean not saying that they're absolutely wrong when you think they are, because I think that, which is now such a common postmodern relativism, you know, is a serious mistake. I'm sure you don't make that, but one has to speak up for one's absolute right to tell other people that their beliefs are a load of rubbish. Yes, one also has to speak up for the right to say sometimes they're pernicious rubbish. Yeah, neo-Nazi beliefs, for example. Yeah, and the kind of phony and bogus liberalism and tolerance of a certain brand of postmodern, I think, is actively dangerous and intellectually very suspicious. But that's not the point you're making. What I loved about my old friend and enemy and sparring partner Christopher Hitchens, who's just died, is that, you know, he didn't say, as a convinced atheist, well, of course, everybody has their place and all beliefs have something of value. He said, religion is disgusting. I don't agree with that at all. And I'd fight Christopher on that, but I think that's so bracing as against all the kind of shamefaced, well, I'm sure if you believe it, there must be something in it. Nonsense. People have believed all kinds of things which there's nothing in and which are, you know, which are actively dangerous. And we mustn't be so mealy-mouthed that we don't say so. You know? Think of, you know, the frightful curses that Jesus calls down on the heads of the Pharisees, for example. Nothing nice and postmodern about that. When you say about the individual, crucifixion and resurrection, the life of the individual, well, let's not forget perhaps that although that has been the focus so much, the crucifixion and resurrection in Christian terms are about humanity, and they're about individuals insofar as individuals participate in that humanity, in that communal being. It's part of the false individualism, surely, of a modern age, that we think of these things, we always start with the individual, and often, as it were, with a very privatized version of the individual. On the contrary, we're individuals only because we share in a species and in a community. You know, we're only persons because we're in communication. And therefore, I think that the, what you call, as it were, the social meaning of this is the primary one. And that Christians simply haven't, I think, thought enough about the political dimensions of death and resurrection, you know, which extend in their implications far beyond the life of the individual in that sense. So, you know, in a sense, I mean, that's what I think there are forms of politics which are hospitable to that insight, and I think there are forms of politics like our present forms that are not. And that Christianity has to be a kind of critique of those present forms in that sense.
What I'm interested in is perhaps your predictions or estimations as to what's going to happen in the relatively near future as regards the resurrection of the deity, in the sense that there's going to be a lot of pressures, economic pressures, physical pressures, political pressures, etc., due to dwindling resources in the virtually immediate future. And it will be necessary for political leaders to motivate vast numbers of individuals to serve their will. Can you perhaps predict how will the resurrection of the deity serve in this matter?
In a word, no. Can I just make a general point about this business of prediction? And again, forgive me, because I've made this point many times in other contexts. You know. The prophet is not in the business of prediction. That's the clairvoyant. That's people who appear into crystal balls or into the entrails of the system and assure its leaders that their prophets are safe for the next 30 years. Yeah. People who want to try and control the future, yeah, have the future in their pocket now. Marx, of course, notoriously, famously, refused to pre-draft or predict the future. That was a good Jewish thing to do, even though Marx was a secular Jew. Yeah? Not trying to predict the future. The prophet is the one who says, if you don't change your ways, there won't be a future. Or at least it'll be very unpleasant. Yeah. Not pre-drafting, not blueprints, you know, not the kind of politics with which Karl Marx started his career in conflict with, the kind of wouldn't it be nice if politics. Let's draw up a blueprint of a perfect society kind of politics, which Marx furiously rejected as a purely intellectualist abstraction from the tasks in hand. Yeah? And Marx called communism not the goal one was aiming at, but the process itself. Yes. For Marx, everything that's happened to date is he won't even grace with the title of history. It's prehistory. The only historic thing to do would be to get history going in all of its variety and diversity and individual fulfillment. And about that, he has nothing whatsoever to say. Why? Because that, by definition, can't be predicted or pre-drafted. Yeah. Anybody can rather idly make their predictions about what's going to happen. But what is the point of doing that? Is what it's a question I would turn back, as it were, on yourself. I don't think that's the task in hand.
Okay. Well, I think it's probably time to draw this to a close. But I'd like to say on behalf of everyone that I think this agree with me that this was a marvelous education of a couple of days, a marvelous narrative of a couple hundred years, rich, interwoven, complex, fascinating, provocative. Your answer to that final question now allows me to understand a letter you wrote to me a couple of years ago when I invited you to come to the Firth Lectures, which seemed quite a long way off in 2010. You said, yes, you'd come give them if the world still existed then. So now I know what sort of prophet you were being. So if you'll join me very much in thanking Professor Eagleton for a marvelous delivery of these Firth Lectures.